how are things in LA and in the States in general? What was it like coming back after being here for?
Not great at first, but I got vaccinated, and that's makes a big difference.
Yes. Yeah.
And it's starting to get a lot better here. So.
Well, that's good. Yeah. The vaccinations seem to be a big thing over there. Hopefully we'll start getting them here as well.
So, yeah. I think if, well, your country, you probably won't have as many knuckleheads as we have. So my guess is that you'd be able to get 70% pretty easily.
I would think so. Yeah. I would hope so. Yeah. So anyway, congratulations on the record.
Thank you.
Copy of it right here.
Right.
I got a blue vinyl version, which is pretty cool. So loving it. My first question is for you, is there any difference between being a member of Crowded House or being their producer at this point?
Oh, it's a huge difference. It's a completely different job.
Right.
This band at this point too, I don't think anybody could produce Crowded House at this point because of the amount of experience within the group. If taking me out of it.
Right.
But, you know, when we started, Neil and I, with the first Crowded House records, we didn't have as much experience. So now, I mean, I give my opinion, but it's everyone has a very strong musical opinion. So, you know, you mostly just look to the singer of the song to see what he likes. You offer up ideas, and right. So it's very different. The biggest difference for me, which is just actually kind of a relief, is I'm used to being the first person everyone looks at for an opinion.
Right.
And in this case, it wouldn't even be welcome. So, you know, it's not. That no one's looking to me to make these decisions. That they're everyone's way too evolved musically for that. So
right.
We have different kinds of discussions.
Gotcha. So what kind of discussions did you have? What led you to become a member and this album appearing? What was the genesis of it for you?
The genesis? Neil called me.
Yeah.
At first I was a little hesitant, but then he set up a rehearsal. That's what convinced me, was the first time everyone got in a room and we started playing, and I just realized how good it could be. And I've always been a very big fan of bands that play in their own unique style.
Right.
And this felt like it had that pretty much right away.
Right.
Yeah, that is something where you could get superior musicians, but you couldn't get anyone that would be better than any of us for the band. And
right.
that felt like kind of a big deal to me, and it just felt like a lot of fun.
Yeah. And of course, now the band has a bunch of different relationships within it. There's Nick and Neil, who've been with the band from day one. There's Neil and his sons, who are also, and then there's your relationship with everybody else. So does it take some sorting out, or is it all kind of feel natural?
I don't think that kind of thing takes sorting out where there's ego involved.
Right.
Or where there's dissatisfaction.
Yep.
But, you know, Liam is, for example, he's made a lot of his own records now.
Sure.
So he's not feeling like if he works with Crowded House sometimes as a guitarist, sometimes he plays drums, sometimes, you know, he sings, sometimes he'll bring in a song. He can enjoy it. He doesn't feel like it's taking away from anything. And so none of us feel that. And we're just happy to see how good we can get.
Right.
And not take stuff personally. So that aspect of it is really made it.
Excellent.
A lot of fun, yeah.
So when did the recording process begin? How long ago?
It was last year. I think we first rehearsed sometime in December.
Right.
2 years ago, I guess, or a year and a half.
2019, yeah.
And we started recording, I think it was January, February, something like that, of a year before this. You know?
Right.
So And then luckily, Neil had a lot of songs and Liam had a song, and we got to rehearse and we got to record together in a studio. And then the pandemic hit.
Right.
So basically for overdubs, we ended up being on our own.
Right.
And sending stuff back and forth and that sort of thing. So we got the I'm sure you've heard the record, but it feels yes. like a band playing together, which it sure. is.
Yeah.
And then,
So you had to go back to the States at that point?
We were doing it all in the States.
Oh, you were, right.
So we had a couple of real cool studios here. At that time, Neil was staying here and his sons, you know, the boys are staying here. And
right.
Nick was the only one we had to bring over. So
So at that point, when the pandemic hit, what kind of discussions did you have? Is this like, oh, well, we just have to deal with this however we can?
Yeah, we were grateful that we had gotten as far as we had.
Yeah.
And then we just quickly decided, which is something that this group seems to be good at, is just how do you maximize any situation?
Yeah.
So for me, the benefit was I had originally brought a bunch of keyboards to the studio, and I just thought, oh, we're just going to do it all in front of each other.
Right.
But going home and being isolated and having all my keyboards around and being able to experiment a lot and send stuff back and forth really ended up being a big positive for the record.
Okay.
It's hard to know what would have happened if we hadn't had that time, but
yep.
it certainly, you could point to a number of things that people did on their own that were pretty substantial things. So
I've been talking to quite a few musicians who've been having to deal with similar situations, and they're having to rethink how they make records, and they realize that there are pluses and minuses, unexpected pluses, like you just mentioned. Do you think once this is kind of done, whatever it's done, that it's going to change the way people think about how they record and how they use a studio?
That was already happening.
Right.
And mostly for financial reasons.
Yeah.
You know, people are having to do stuff remotely and do stuff at home. That's been very well established. I think what has done more than anything is make people really want to get in a room together and play music. So a lot of my friends and stuff that are making records, it seems more and more, they're just saying, let's do it live in the studio. Let's yep. get a, because that's the thing we all missed.
Yeah. Yeah. Now you mentioned that Neil had a lot of songs, and of course Liam is.
Yeah.
Is trying, so how did you, what was the process like of getting it down to the songs that comprise the record?
Well, that was, it was pretty clear which ones were good, but it wasn't a band discussion. It was mostly Neil.
Okay.
And quite a few, even after the sessions, he must have torn apart two or three songs and reconfigured them into better songs. So, you know, it's a struggle. I think our attitude was, let's just finish everything. And, right. and a few didn't make it, but it wasn't, there weren't battles about it.
Yeah.
Kind of seemed evident.
It doesn't seem like it would be a band with battles in it.
Well, there were, you know.
Okay.
You know, when we were all younger and
right.
and our egos were tied into the band, and you know, people were more emphatic about things.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. No, I meant you know, these days it didn't seem like there would be
no
it much to fight about anymore. You kind of.
Yeah, but music. Music is difficult.
Yeah.
And there are disagreements, and you tend to believe what you believe. So,
yeah.
You know, the way it works in this band is if there's a serious disagreement, you just speak your mind and then let it go.
Right.
It's not, you know, it's up to whoever's singing it, because he has to feel good singing it. So,
yeah.
It's pretty clear.
And of course, you have a unique position in the fact that you've worked with so many other musicians. I mean, one look at your roster, the list of people you worked with is just incredible. That's got to have some kind of play into how you are able to interact with anybody these days. What have you learned the most from working with all this variety of people that you've, I mean, it's everybody from Bob Dylan and Paul McCartney to like Peter Case and, you know, everybody in between.
If there's anything that you learn, it's a real privilege of a job.
Uh-huh.
And there's a number of people that kind of give that job a bad name in my, they don't show up.
Right.
They don't take it seriously. They, they're more interested in being the big shot or whatever. And I just don't rate them at all. Even if they've made some good records, I don't rate it because it's really a squandering of an opportunity. So what you learn ultimately is how to listen. Uh-huh. If there's one thing. And it's something that I've been working on a lot. And I think I've, over the past few years, I've become a much better listener. So, you know, for example, if you're in the studio, everybody hears things.
Yeah.
You go like, oh, well, that could be there. Or, oh, this or that. But if you listen really well, you tend to know more that, okay, well, that could happen, but maybe that's better left alone. Or, yeah, that's a beginning of an idea, but that's not a complete idea. Or, you know, you learn how to listen in a more serious way. So.
Gotcha. So getting into the record itself, into the album, what can you tell me? Are there any particular tracks that stand out that were particularly, well, have a story behind them as far as how they were made?
I don't know. I don't know about the story. Neil would probably have more stories because it's more what he had in mind when he was writing it.
Yeah.
I mean, one of my favorite tracks is the opening track. I just happen to love that song.
Uh-huh.
And I'm when I first went to the first rehearsal, when I arrived, they were playing that sort of 5/4 pattern.
Right.
And I thought, oh, that's pretty nice. But I didn't think there was any way that was going to be a song. It just seemed like, oh, that's kind of nice. We'll get to work. And the song that Neil ended up writing over it became one of my favorite songs. So that was really, that one for me was really fulfilling to have that thing be realized and then be so good.
Hey, everybody wants to make a better
Yeah. I mean, I played the record this morning and you just put the needle on and that warm kind of feeling just kind of washes over you when you hear that.
Yeah, I really fought. If I fought for one thing, it was that should be the opening track.
Was it much of a battle or was everybody in kind of
agreement? You know, everybody had different ideas, but I kept coming back to it. So I think they finally just let me have my way. But to me, to have a song that's that catchy and simple in 5/4 and then it goes to 6/4. And it just sounds inevitable. It just sounded very Crowded House, but also original at the same time. And I don't know. I just really thought it was a great way to open things up.
Right. Now I noticed that there's a couple songs that Liam has written for the band. Was that a surprise?
No. That was the idea.
Okay.
I mean, he wrote some with Neil, and then he wrote one of his own, and then Elroy wrote one too. I mean, the idea. Neil is very. And he's always had that, you know, Paul Hester used to write a couple songs and if it's a band, it shows something. As long as the songs are good, it just shows another side to things. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. And there's a song called Start Something that co-written with Liam and Neil, and the harmonies are just amazing on that.
The call has come through. You're so
how much when that gets made, is that a long involved process? Does it happen relatively naturally? How does it go?
The to work out who's going to sing it or how?
Yeah, and to actually get it down right.
Yeah, well, they envision the song as a two-part harmony song, you know, like Weather With You or the Everly Brothers, you know.
They
have a really good blend, and so it was thought of right from the beginning. And I think that was Neil's chorus, and then Liam wrote the verse, and they put it together, and it came together pretty quickly.
Oh,
and then they tried singing it a few times, but I wasn't around. It was all done. That part was done in isolation. Some of the vocals were done later. So
when things are done in isolation, you may not be around for decisions made or sounds being laid down. And then when it comes back to you, Are you surprised? Do you have any input?
Sometimes horrified, sometimes surprised. The thing that, if there's one thing that's confusing about it, is that all of us have a lot of experience, but none of us are engineers.
Ah, okay.
So the mix that you send somebody else is something that just kind of sounds good to you.
Right.
It can sound absolutely crazy to the guy that's receiving it. So you don't know what the person's thinking, you know? And then sometimes Neil would be, he would be singing, so he would get a really crazy balance,
yep,
and then just leave it. And then you receive it, and then you think, is that what he likes?
Yep.
Or is that just something that he did? So that's where things can take a bit longer, because there's more room for that. It's best if there's one engineer who's controlling the sound, controlling the mixing, so that when things are added, everyone gets it. But occasionally it can go a little nuts for a while. And
gotcha. Cool. So the other thing that happened while you were here was that Crowded House toured.
Yeah.
And I saw your show at the Spark Arena there, and it was a beautiful thing. I'm just wondering what highlights were there for you and, you know, the band in general. I mean, it was a beautiful moment because we had 12,000 people all together and the rest of the world was all isolated. It was amazing.
The whole thing was amazing. Every single day, because I was coming out of really strict isolation.
Right.
And all of a sudden it was released in the world, playing music with the band, you know, hanging out, like having a good time. And then the shows, you know, we were playing really well. I thought we really got good as we were going.
Yep.
And we had prepared a lot. I had personally prepared a tremendous amount so that we could get good pretty fast. A lot of times keyboards are complicated to get right. And so I spent a good amount of time preparing for it.
So when you say preparing, are you just practicing?
Well, yeah. Well, what we would do, and I thought it was really a great idea, is that everyone just recorded their parts of about, I guess, 20 songs or something. And so I had everyone playing. It wasn't exactly what they were going to play, but it helped me in terms of figuring out how things should sound and where I could come in. And I did practice a lot, which, you know, I would run it all the time. I felt strange. I felt like I was in a crazy guy, like trying to audition for a Crowded House cover band or something, you know, just going out every day, playing along with the band. It was really a bizarre feeling, you know.
Yep. Well,
helped.
But it was quite a show. And when the set list was put together for the show, did everybody kind of contribute, or was that mostly up to Neil?
It's up to Neil, and it got best because by the end he could just completely change the set list, which is it's a good idea because every song sounds different if it's coming after something else.
Yeah.
And so it's a more exciting to play, and that whole programming, the whole show it can just feel like a, you know, a bit rote after a while. You sort of know what's coming and all that, even though Neil always interjects moments that things kind of go off the rails. So
yeah, cool.
But it's a matter of keeping it alive. And right. So I think that if every song we play is well played and is a good song, you can mix them up. It doesn't matter that much.
Sure, yeah. So the record is out today. What are the plans for the band? Are you guys touring the world, the U.S.
We had to cancel the U.S. portion this year, but we're going to Australia at the end of the year.
Oh, cool.
Which should be great. I think early December, late November. And then the U.S. next, I think, March, and then Europe in the summer. So,
yeah.
You know, I mean, I got into this, it was all supposed to happen in 1 year.
Yeah, I'm sure.
And then the whole world tour, but now it's been a number of years. So,
yeah. And for you, I mean, you're working on, it seems like a million things at once and with all sorts of different people. What's it been like for you to have to kind of deal with this fact that nobody's traveling? If you're going to do something with somebody, it's working on Zoom or something like that. I mean, have you had to rethink what you're up to?
Well, when it happened, I got in the band, so I considered my job. Yeah. And then there's some bits and pieces of things I was finishing up, which I've been doing remotely.
Right.
But I didn't, on purpose, I didn't really want to try to book another album or anything like that.
Right.
It just was the wrong time. I was sort of glad to get a break from it. So.
So are you thinking in terms of maybe doing more production and engineer, or not?
I have a few things lined up. I'm doing something right now with Randy Newman, another song, cool. And maybe another record with Rufus Wainwright, if depending on the timing. But I'm happy not to be that, you know.
Right.
It's time for a change. I've produced a lot of records, you know.
Yes, you have.
30 or something. I mean, and at a certain point, I love doing it.
Yep.
At a certain point, it's good to change it up, and, sure. And being a musician is just a great thing, you know. And sometimes producing, I get further and further away from being a musician as far as playing and all that. So,
right, cool. Well, it sounds like you're finding a balance there or something. And
yeah, and it feels good to just have my primary thing, the thing everything has to work around, is the band.
Yeah,
I like that. I got no problem with that.
And is the band thinking in terms of more recording and what we're going to do next?
Well, it's a step at a time, but there seems to be a lot of enthusiasm for it.
Yeah.
And so I'm, you know, as long as everyone's getting on and it's a positive thing, you know, and I think everyone's feeling that. I think we're kind of surprised how well it went. And, but, you know, we're not, it's not like, oh, we're going to do this for 20 years because, you know, I don't know how long I'm going to be around.
Same for all of us, I'm afraid. I mean, the idea that, I mean, my hero is Ian Hunter, who just turned 82 yesterday, I think it was. Bob Dylan just turned 80. I interviewed Judy Collins the other day. She's like 80 something. I mean, it's insane that that's even happening, you know. So
I saw him in play in the, when was it? It was in the early 80s or something,
right
here in LA, and he was incredible.
Yeah.
Mick Ronson. Yeah, was playing guitar, and they just shook the building, man. It was a great show.
Yeah. Now, I went to their reunion shows, the Mott the Hoople reunion shows, like in 2009, and at that point he was in his 70s, and he looked like he was 40. It was amazing.
Yeah,
it was amazing. But so, Well, anyway, thank you very much for sharing all that with me. And
well, thank you, Marty.
My pleasure. But believe me, and hopefully, if you're touring Australia, feel free to come back here and do a couple more shows. Wouldn't mind seeing some more.
Sure.
Yeah. So, let me know. Great.